process. But I think what that started for me was this really interesting way of looking at storytelling and looking at creativity and looking at technology and entrepreneurship and kind of mixing them all together. We all know now that it's very common for pre-production and production and post to all kind of merge together. And I think what's really interesting about this 21st century opportunity to tell stories is this ability to kind of start thinking about things in a more creative way. So here we are today at Audience Connect, and one of the things that I want to talk about is kind of designing with, and this amazing kind of thing that kind of opened up where, you know, story is effectively the same, but it's the telling that's changing, right? So in that sense that telling is changing, in the sense that consumption patterns are changing, and the rapid advancement of technology creates amazing opportunities for those who are willing to experiment. So what I'm basically going to show you in this session is a number of different things that have been experiments that I've been working on over the past, over the last 10 years or so. And I'm very much about kind of making work quickly, rapidly prototyping, failing quickly, learning from that failure and applying it and moving forward. So the first, I just want to kind of give you a little overview of some of the work that I've done to give you a context. So I started, after the last broadcast, I made a movie that was called Head Trauma, and I became really interested in this idea of merging games with head trauma. And I became interested in this idea of how I could tell the movie or expand it beyond a single screen. And so it had a traditional release, came out theatrically. I did it myself, 17-city theatrical release in the United States, and then I licensed it out to Warner Brothers for release in the States. But where it got really interesting was when I kind of recontextualized the actual film. And what I mean by that is it had been out, and I decided that I was going to take it out and I was going to show it in museums and college campuses, and I was going to remix it effectively. And what that basically meant was when somebody would come to see the movie, I would build an experience. And I'm going to walk you through a very simple user flow to give you a sense of what that means. So somebody would get off the subway, and this is 2007, and they would be making their way to the venue. And they would walk down the street, and we had written software where at the time there were still payphones. We had written software that would allow all the payphones up and down the block to ring, right? And so when somebody walked by and they answered the phone, they'd hear like this fragmented conversation, and effectively they would hear what was a foreshadowing element of the movie. The movie itself was a psychological thriller about a drifter who comes home after 20 years, settle his grandmother's estate, finds it condemned and inhabited by squatters, and as he's trying to fix it, he falls, strikes his head, starts having these reoccurring nightmares that cross over into his reality. And so a lot of the design of it was really kind of based on that. So, and it was all about repressed memories, a little spoiler there about the film. So when somebody would come down and they'd answer the phone, they'd hear these fragmented conversations, and then they make their way around the corner, and there was a street preacher there that was handing out these, if anybody is into comics, they might know Jack Chick. He does these weird religious propaganda comics in the States that you find in like phone booths or that you find in rest stops, or, you know, they're just very bizarre. And Stephen Bissett, who works, he had collaborated a lot with Alan Moore, he co-created Constantine and Swamp Thing. He was a fan of my first film, and so he inked these comics for me. So the street preacher standing there on the corner handing out, you know, preaching fire and brimstone and handing out these comics to whoever will take them. For anybody that took the time to look at them and they kind of opened them up and, you know, held them up to the light, they'd see there are all these codes and ciphers within the comic itself. And then when they made their way into the theater, the movie was rescored live by musicians and DJs. Characters came out and scared people, very William Castle-esque. And then we wrote software that allowed people to interact with their mobile phone in the movie. So when you would come in, there'd be a sign that said, no matter what you do, do not call this number, do not text this number, danger, 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 don't do it. 90-some-odd% of the audience did, at which point we had them, you know. And so effectively what would happen would be when the movie started up, I would say, you know, please leave your phones on, you know, for the film. And we started ringing all the phones throughout the audience and started connecting people to each other via their phones and started hiding things on different people's phones and encouraging people to connect with each other and pushing a meta narrative to them. After they would leave the theater, and they would go home, and if they looked at the back of that comic, it said, "Do you want to play a game?" At which point they would go onto a website, and the website was very similar. It was actually like that comic, except it was interactive. And at a certain point, their phone would ring, and they'd answer their phone, and it would be the nemesis from the movie. It was all sound design, built to scale, and that whatever they would say into the phone would launch video or audio on their computer screen. So all of a sudden, they'd start to move through this experience. And at a certain point, the character would say to them, you know, "Tell me something about yourself that nobody knows," at which point, whatever they said through the phone would be looped back through the computer speakers. It would totally freak them out. And so they go and they try to close it, but we build a fake exit box. So they'd be clicking on that, and we know that they were clicking on that, and we'd deliver a message back to the phone, said, "Where do you think you're going? We're not finished yet." At which point, we would effectively drop them into conversations with other people who were experiencing the same thing at the same time. So what I just described to you is like a really interesting arc, right? It's like, it starts with a communal experience, it goes to a mobile, goes to online, and then back to communal again. That technology that we developed, we then licensed multiple times to other parties, and I became really interested in this gap that exists with the infrastructure and what's possible with storytelling in the 21st century. So moving forward.